Hello, I am Seamus Dunhu of EVE University, and this is episode 5 of How to Survive EVE Online. Let's log in. And let's go through our checklist real quick. Your checklist might wind up being a little different from mine.
Skill training completed.
So I believe it's been about an hour and a half since I ended the last recording. And I've trained Mechanics 3 and Cybernetics 1. So I'm going to go ahead and plug in my Charisma implant. And let's see. Advanced Industry needs Industry Level 3. Mass Production, same thing. Salvaging I can train right now, so let's train that to Level 1. Hacking still needs electronics upgrades level 3. Survey I already have. And retail is waiting on trade level 2. Alright. So for production, let me. Okay, I've already got industry level 3 slotted in, as well as electronics upgrades level 3. It's just going to take a while. Alright. I have 106,000 skill points, which is still covered quite well by a clone alpha, so I don't have to worry about that. I am in an NPC corp, so I'm not at war with anybody. Nobody can shoot at me unprovoked without Concord intervention. And somebody sent me an email, which doesn't look too important. So, alright, we're going to get started on the military chain. So we're going to talk to the military agent. Cash flow for capsuleers. Clear the pirates from the asteroid belt, as your agent has requested, on behalf of a group of miners. Click accept. And close. And let me double check to make sure my ship is fitted appropriately. No, it is not. Good thing I double checked that. Let's see. These are small focused A-modals. Where's my other... Here it is. Alright, load that up, and now I'm ready to go. Let's undock. By the way, you might see this blinking red skull icon. That means that particular player committed a criminal action sometime in the past 15 minutes. In high security space, that usually means he shot at somebody unprovoked. Which can happen, but is usually limited to people who are carrying way too much valuable stuff in their cargo hold. The guy who opens fire and destroys the victim is in turn fried by Concord, but then the accomplice who never fired a shot flies on up to both wrecks and loots everything, sells it all, and splits the proceeds with the guy who originally opened fire. This is known as the practice of suicide ganking. So you don't want to have too much expensive stuff in your cargo hold at any given time. The tougher your ship is, then the more firepower needs to be brought to bear against your ship in order to destroy it before Concord shows up. Scroll out a bit, hold down Alt to see my own location. There we go. So we're going to target lock this guy and approach him. And my weapons can hit out to about 9 kilometers. Good enough. I'm going to turn on the afterburner, turn off the afterburner. I just want to run it one cycle. Let me get a little closer to that wreck. Control spacebar, full stop. I don't want to overshoot this target. And let's loot it. And I'm going to right-click, save location. I am not going to change the name to Safe Spot just yet, because I'm going to demonstrate salvaging later on. Let me approach that target. Let me lock all these things. I can only target lock up to 40,000 meters. All right. So some of these targets are 40 kilometers away, but you can use afterburners now, so you can cover the distance more quickly. That's why I had you run the business and industry chains first. They give you the afterburner skill book. Alright, click this guy, click approach. Oh, he's on the other side of that structure. Alright, I'm gonna double click off in this direction. By the way, sometimes combat missions are decorated with asteroids of various kinds. If you want to mine them for minerals, you can. But you need to remember to do that mining before you turn in the mission. Otherwise, the asteroids go poof along with the rest of the mission when you turn in the mission. Now, these buttons also have hotkeys. So if you mouse over it, you can see what those hotkeys are. Q for approach, S for warp, W for orbit, E for keep at range, so on and so forth. So you can click once on the target, then tap Q for approach, and your ship will approach that target. If I want to orbit it, I can click once on the target and tap W. It's important to note that these hotkeys only work if the overview or if the background has focus, meaning that you've clicked at least once in that part of the interface. If something else has focus, like your chat channel window, then your hotkeys are not going to work. F1, the function keys, however, will always work even if something else has focus. So even if I'm currently, even if a chat channel has focus, tapping F1 will still turn on or turn off the lasers. I'm going to double click away from this guy because beam lasers really, really not made for orbiting that well. Let's return to the station.
Warp drive active.
And turn off the afterburner. You know what? As long as we're warping back, let me have you buy capacitor management. Remember this book icon. Let's buy this.
Docking permission requested. Docking request accepted.
Capacitor systems operation. What are you doing? And hull upgrades. Again, the book icon, not any of the implants. We are going to click, control click, then let go of control, right click, and inject all three. And let's see here. So under engineering, I'm going to have you slot in capacitor management. That could go in later. Capacitor management and capacitor systems operation are skills that will improve your capacitor without having to attach modules. You might still want cap recharger or cap power relay modules anyway, but this is another option for improving your capacitor. And you also want hull upgrades level 1, so I'm going to slot that in pretty soon. Alright, so click apply, and we can close this. Let's talk to the military agent and turn in the mission. And the game will tell you about the repair shop. Basically, if you want to repair armor and structure in station without having to run undock and run your modules, you can. A more direct way to do this, you can right-click the ship in question and get a repair quote, and nothing is damaged in my case. Generally, you would probably want to use your own modules to repair your armor under most circumstances. But let's see. Let's request the next mission. And we need to eliminate the pirates and rescue a civilian miner. So we're going to accept the mission. They give us motion prediction. Let's just inject that for now. Alright, let's see. Do I need anything? No. Undock. And warp to location.
Warp drive active.
Alright, let's approach and turn on the afterburner. There are a couple of ways you can use hotkeys. You can either tap the thing in overview, click the thing in overview once, and then tap Q. Or you can hold down Q and then click the over thing in overview. Either method will work. Alright, now I'm going to turn off the afterburner because I don't want to be going too fast when I get in range. There we go. Save this wreck as location, and let me approach the other guy. Turn on the afterburner again. You can fire from out of range. You're just going to miss quite a lot. Click. Turn on the afterburner. Again, I'm turning on the afterburner with Alt F1 or Option F1, and I am firing the lasers with just plain old F1. And if I'm taking armor damage, I can control F1 to turn on the armor repair. Alright. The guy we need to rescue is inside the cargo container. Loot all. And just grab that loot, and we are done here.
Warp drive active.
And the dock button is hotkeyed to D. So you can hold down D and click once on the station. Let go of D, and when your ship drops out of warp, your ship will dock of its own accord. Hands off the keyboard.
Docking permission.
There you
requested.
Go.
Docking request accepted.
Alright. Complete the mission. Let's request the next mission. And let's see. Here we We need to destroy the pirates, loot the secret documents from the container they leave behind, and report back. So let's click accept. And we are given a civilian stasis webifier to work with if we want to. Let me get this out of the way. So if we want to use this, let's pull out a mid-slot module. Let's throw in the stasis webifier. Close the fitting window and close this, and let's undock. Now, what a stasis webifier does is that it will slow down a target, by which I mean it reduces the target's maximum velocity. Its current velocity will decay down to the new value if it was going faster than that, but it does reduce the maximum velocity, making it an easier target to hit. Where are these guys? There they are. I'm just going to run the afterburner for one cycle. Alright, that Weber drone is capable of slowing me down. See. Webified drone Weber, and now he's dead. That Weber drone was trying to slow me down and make me an easier target. But I killed it. Click, save location, return, and let me target lock these other guys. Let me webify this runner drone. And you know what? That brings up another point. Let me open the overview setting. Normally, combat is a bad time to be playing with overview settings, but tutorial targets don't do a lot of damage. So, click here. Open overview settings. On the columns tab, let's turn on velocity, radial velocity, and angular velocity. So velocity shows how fast the target is moving in any direction. Radial velocity is how fast it's moving towards or away from you. And angular velocity is how quickly it's moving around you in circles. So this runner drone can only go at 195 meters per second, and it's now dead. This Corpy follower is going at 219 with the webifier on it. It's now slowing down, and it's easier for me to hit that thing. Ignore the devout, or whatever the other racial version of it is. You can't kill it, it's just there for show. So let's approach this last target, webify it, and then shoot it. Alright, with that being done, let's start looting Rex. And let's go loot the cargo container. Turn on the afterburner again. Double left click the cargo container. And here are the secret documents. Now we can return to the station.
Warp drive active. Docking permission requested. Docking request accepted.
All right. Everything screen check marks. Let's complete the mission. And we are going to inject the propulsion jamming skill. And let's slot that in. Where should we slot that in? Electronic systems, let's put that in after hull upgrades. Click apply and close this. Let's request the next mission. Warp to the dead space area, find the Stargate and approach it. So let's click accept and close. And the game's going to throw text at you about shield tanking. I don't think we need it. Our armor repair is good enough. By the way, given that ships have a structure, armor, and shield layer, one of the mistakes new players make is to try to tank both the armor and the shield layers to make their ships tougher. Usually this is a bad idea. You only want to focus on optimizing your armor or optimizing your shields to sustain battle damage. The reason being that your other slots, whatever you're using for, not using for tanking, can usually be used for something else. If you're shield tanking, that's taking up your mid slots. That leaves your low slots free for damage increasing modules, modules that increase your ship's agility or speed, so on and so forth. Let's click on that Stargate in the middle of that cluster formation. If you're having trouble finding it, you can go to your overview settings and add large collidable structure to overview. But anyway, let's approach this thing. Nothing yet. Save this location as a safe spot. I'm expecting this thing to start hitting me with damage. Yes, sometimes structures or sometimes large collidable structures can be scripted to do damage to your ship, which is what I'm expecting to happen here. I don't know why it hasn't happened yet. Also, my ship seems to be caught on invisible collision surfaces, which is kind of common with irregularly shaped objects. Come on, what is taking this thing so long? Alright, I don't like this. I'm getting caught on collision surfaces too much. Let me back out of here before this event suddenly decides it wants to start working correctly. Alright, I'm a little confused. This thing was supposed to do something by now. I'm double left-clicking in space a lot, trying to fly my ship around. As long as I'm getting caught on invisible collision surfaces, I may as well explain that. The art geometry is very irregular, but in EVE Online, actual collisions, objects are modeled as one or more spheres for the purposes of calculating collision. So these things that you see in space are actually made up of a set of balls. You cannot actually see those collision surfaces. They are not explicitly drawn for you, but Crowd Control Productions designers ostensibly have set those collision surfaces to approximate the shape of the object in question, which is something you want to be aware of in case you start flying close to objects like this. Why is this taking so long? There it goes. Now I want to get out of here fast because it's going to do damage to me. Yes, a large collidable structure is doing damage to me. Now that I'm clear of obstacles, I can warp back to the station.
Warp drive active.
Turn off the afterburner. We're going to hold down D and click once on the station.
Docking permission requested. Docking request accepted.
All right, talk to the military agent. We complete the mission and request the next mission. Here, we are granted, okay, we need to meet up with a pirate at a repair outpost, and see what he wants, so let's click accept, and close, and undock. And the game will throw text at you about, different damage types. Let's warp to the location. So damage always comes in one of four types in EVE Online: electromagnetic, thermal, kinetic, and explosive. That's what these colored bars are. If somebody smacks my shields with 100 points of explosive damage, I'll only take 50 points off. If somebody smacks me with 100 points of thermal, I only take 80 points off. It is possible to increase resistances. You'll be thrown text. You can read that at your own leisure. I won't waste your time.
Skill training completed.
Salvaging is complete. So we're going to webify this guy and shoot him. By the way, the reason I had you put angular velocity on here, it's in radians per second. Your tracking speeds are also in radians per second. So generally, you want to keep your target moving slower than your tracking speed, assuming that it's a target the same size that your guns expect. Right click. Save this location. And let's return to station.
Warp drive active.
Hold down D, click on the station. How much money do you have? 1.7 million. There's another skill I will have you get at some point, either the most likely next episode, called high-speed maneuvering. But that requires that you have trained Afterburner level 3. I can slot in level 2 right now, but level 3 is going to require that I push something beyond the 24-hour limit. So let me talk to the military agent, complete the mission, and request the next mission. And here we are asked to destroy the Devout's outpost. We can find it in the final room of the complex. So let's click accept. And undock. By the way, this yellow exclamation mark is the non-capsular log-off timer. You've probably seen it quite a number of times. I haven't explained it yet. Basically, if you log off your ship in space and you don't have this timer, if you just do a quit or your modem disconnects or what have you, your ship will hang around, will make one attempt to warp to a random point 1 million kilometers away, and in succeed or fail, it will sit there for 1 minute and then disappear from space. And once it disappears from space, you can't be attacked anymore. If you have the NPC combat timer, this thing, you're going to sit there until that timer expires. And if you've been in combat with a player, this will be a red exclamation mark, and you're going to sit there for 15 minutes before you disappear from space. Assuming, of course, nobody probes your ship with combat probes and warps to you and kills you. Full stop. The reason I'm currently stopped at the moment is because I don't want to drag these guys all over the place. I'd like them to die in a relatively close pile. Because I'm going to demonstrate salvaging towards the end of the episode. But if I wanted to try to take less damage, I would move around. Remember, moving around somebody in circles reduces their ability to hit you. It also reduces your ability to hit them, so it comes down to a question of who has the better tracking speed. Webify. Remember, I'm using hotkeys for a lot of this. Alt F1 for the afterburner, Alt F2 for the civilian stasis webifier, F1 for the lasers. Double left click to fly manually in a given direction. Can I activate this acceleration gate now? No, I can't. It's locked. Webify and shoot. Sometimes these guys are moving slow enough that I don't have to webify them in order to kill them. Let me grab that loot real quick. Control spacebar, open cargo, and activate the acceleration gate. By the way, double left clicking an acceleration gate is interpreted as an approach command, which isn't too helpful in and of itself. So there's the Devout's outpost. It's all by its lonesome, supposedly. You target lock it, and you start shooting it. Oh look, it's a trap. Now, I gave my ship a command to orbit one of these defense sentries. But first, let me see if I can actually click one of the moving targets. Kill that. There we go. That's not the one I wanted to shoot at. Let's shoot the one I'm orbiting. So, like I said, if you're moving around the target in circles, or if it's moving in circles around you, it does reduce your ability to hit that target. It also reduces their ability to hit you, so again, it comes down to a question of who has the greater angular velocity. So, right now I'm able to do damage to him, but he's not able to do damage to me. His shields are going down a lot faster than mine. However, if I control spacebar and come to a full stop, I'll hit him more frequently, and I'll hit him harder. But he's also going to hit me more frequently, and hit me harder. I just lost a big chunk of shield right there. And if I continue sitting still, now I've taken armor damage. I'm going to have to run my armor repairer. And keep in mind, both of those sentries are shooting at me. So let me orbit the one that's still alive. Now, depending on what your ship you're flying, you can take a strategy of just sit there and tank it. It's possible with some setups. But not with the way I have set up this frigate. I've only got an armor repairer and a bunch of capacitor-improving modules. I don't have any resistance modules to reduce the amount of incoming damage. Given these are typically Blood Raiders, I would probably tank EM Thermal, so I would want to use modules that reduce the EM damage that my armor takes, or modules that reduce... Did I accidentally double left-click? Yes, I did. Let me orbit this guy again. And run the afterburner for one cycle. So I could use modules that reduce the amount of EM damage that my armor takes, or reduce the amount of thermal damage that my armor takes. Either of those would work. In this case, I'm just moving around this guy in circles so that I don't get hit. Also known as speed tanking. I don't have to be armored if the guy can't hit me. Let me right-click and save this as separate location. Yes, I know, I already bookmarked the one of the wrecks in the previous room. There's a reason for that. By the way, the game might have thrown text at you about contraband. I wasn't paying attention if that was the case or not, but if it did, then it's applied to the wrong mission. Because none of this is contraband. All of this is perfectly legal, so let's just loot everything. And let's also loot one of these wrecks. By the way, there's a lot of asteroids here. If you want to go mining pyroxeres, your own belt of pyroxeres, plagioclase, veldspar, and whatnot, you can come back in your venture and do mining. But you have to do that before you turn in the mission.
Warp drive active.
I'm going to save this location as Pyroxeres, just to establish that point later. And let me reconsider my skill training options here. I do want to finish electronics upgrades at some point. Let's move up capacitor. And let's dock.
Docking permission requested. Docking request accepted.
Let's talk to the military agent. And complete the mission. And request the next mission. And you know what? I'll take off capacitor systems operation level 3 for now. Let me put afterburner 3 instead. Alright. Destroy the pirates at the convoy ambush site. Let's click accept. And the game will throw text at you about armor tanking. Let's close, and you know what? Let's stack everything in our ship's cargo hold, and let's move it off the ship. We don't need this here. Oh, you know what? We looted a limited 1 meganewton afterburner. This is slightly better than the 1 meganewton afterburner one that we have, so let's actually make use of it. And let's undock. You know what? If we show info on the afterburner, variations tab, click the compare button, I'll actually go into the details in the compare tool. Let's click on meta level. Activation cost, maximum velocity bonus, power grid usage, CPU usage, and I think that's all the relevant ones for an afterburner. And let's click on meta level header. Hold on, let me double left click the compare tool to collapse this. I'll set aside the compare tool for now. Let's kill these things. Start shooting to get their attention. Oh, hey, new things showed up. Control spacebar. Webify this guy, shoot him. Yeah, if your module is flashing red, that means that's already taken a command to shut down, and you gotta wait for that to complete before you can actually turn it on again. Control spacebar, I'm getting too far away from what I want to kill. And I don't think I saved this as a location yet. Alright, they're all over there. Let me get a little closer to them. And control spacebar and webify this guy. Shoot this guy at 10 kilometers. Webify this guy, shoot him. Webify. I'm going to double left click that rec because it's full of something. All of these other rec icons are hollow, meaning that they're empty. So you don't have to bother visiting them. Loot everything. And let's warp to the Cuddle bookmark.
Warp drive active.
Hold down D and click on the station. Let go of D. By the way, you can change any of these shortcuts for approach, warp, orbit, keep at range, dock, and so on and so forth. That's under the escape menu, shortcuts tab, the combat sub tab. You can remap these to whatever you like. But revisiting the compare tool for a moment, the limited 1 meganewton afterburner has a slightly greater maximum velocity bonus than the 1 meganewton afterburner 1. So it gives us more of a speed boost. Everything else about it is the same. Let me talk to the military agent.
Skill training completed.
Complete the mission. Request the next mission. Fly to a hotel your agent mentioned. Retrieve the VIPs. If something is amiss, then report back to your agent with the details. Amiss? What could possibly go amiss? Click accept, click close, and undock. And the game will point out the overview settings to you. Let me just dismiss the text though, we've already discussed this. Now, if you've been paying attention to the mission details for missions that actually want you to bring something back, you've noticed that this one doesn't actually have an object to bring back. And lo and behold, I detect no life signs within the habitation module, and the communication services in the adjacent security towers seems to be down. Let's approach Omar's stop, or whatever the name of this hotel is. The corpses floating around the inn are most likely the people who were ejected through the airlock. So once we get close enough... Why is this not doing anything? And we took some damage. There's also some hostiles. And I can full stop. We can leave if we want to. I want to fry these guys. .19 milliradians per second. Remember, you can show info on your guns. Look at the attributes tab. My tracking speed is 0.1 radians per second. They're moving slower than that, so I should still be able to hit them pretty well. Generally speaking, turrets will miss for two general reasons. Either the target is moving around you in circles, in which case we're talking about angular velocity, tracking speed, the signature radius of the target, and the signature resolution of your guns. Or the target is beyond optimal range. My optimal range is only 5.25 kilometers, and how quickly you start missing a lot because of range is determined by the accuracy falloff. So at 5.25 kilometers, if I'm shooting a stationary target, my shots are guaranteed. Add another 4 kilometers, my chance to hit is down to 1/2. Add another 4 kilometers, my chance to hit is down to 1/16. Add another 4 kilometers to that, my chance to hit is 1 in 512.
Warp drive active.
So let's return to the station.
Docking permission requested. Docking request accepted.
Talk to the agent. Let's complete the mission. He'll give us, he already gave us weapon upgrades, which, see if you can inject that or not. Yes, you can. Can you inject shield management? Yes, you can. Let's not worry about the others right now. Let's request the next mission. Destroy the narcotics warehouse and report back to your agent. So let's click accept. Close. And hold on, let me read the details on that again. The reward is the Stasis Web of Fire 1. They haven't given it to us yet. All right. Sundock.
Warp drive active.
You know what? This destination was almost straight below us. Let me right-click this acceleration gate and down from station and click submit. I will probably explain instant undock bookmarks next episode. This is fortuitous. I got lucky. I'll explain why I got lucky next episode. You can kill these guys if you want to. If I can save some time and not waste your time watching this video, I will probably activate the acceleration gate. The acceleration gate isn't always locked by live enemies near it. Sometimes it is, sometimes it's not. Cut the afterburner, and
warp drive.
We can skip these guys. Let's do that. Alright. The target that you're looking for is somewhere over there. Not radioactive cargo. That's not it. That's not it. Narcotics warehouse. That's the thing. And it is a large collidable structure. If you're having trouble finding it that way, you can go to the overview settings, filters. Is this under entity? Hold on, let me start target locking things. Yes, there is a large collidable structure option here. You can turn that on. Some missions have a hell of a lot of large collidable structures, none of which are actually important to what you're doing. But anyway. Now, let me see if I can shoot this narcotics warehouse right now. Because the objective is to destroy the narcotics warehouse. That's all we need to do. We can kill all the other hostiles that show up. That's fine. If we want to. That's optional. You might want to. Each of these guys is worth 3,000 interstellar credits. Which might start seeming like chump change, given your 2.3 million wallet. And sometimes I reposition my camera so I have good color contrast between my heads-up display and the background, because otherwise I can't see it against this bright asteroid here. Now, if we actually open this cargo container, this has contraband. It has a special icon above the stack count. So there's 10 units of Mind Flood. If we show info on this, there's a legality tab. Hold on, let me target lock the next guy showing up. So this has a legality tab. So if you take this anywhere in high security space, on the next Stargate, not the station, but the Stargates, the NPC police will stop your ship and demand that you hand it over. And if you click no, they're going to shoot at you. So we are not interested in narcotics. There's not anything you can do with these anyway. But we are going to right-click, save this as a location, a wreck, and I'm not going to waste your time. I'm going to return to station.
Warp drive active. Docking permission requested. Docking request accepted.
All right, let's talk to the agent. Complete the mission. Request the next mission. And this one is going to be in Penurgmin. So that will be 3 jumps away. I don't want to do this quite yet because I want to demonstrate salvaging before we go any further. So let me assemble this executioner that I was just given. Let me hop into the executioner. Let me rename it executioner. And we trained up the salvaging skill. Hold on, how many slots do I have on an executioner? I have 4. So let's get How much are tractor beams? A lot. Alright, forget the tractor beams. Let's just get a some salvager modules. Four of them. Right click, buy this. We're going to buy four of them right here in station. And scroll down. Let's find our salvagers. One, or I can right click, fit active ship. Fit to active ship. Fit to active ship. Here's an afterburner. I have extra cap rechargers and cap power relays for running things. And do I have... Yes, I trained hull upgrades. So these overdrive injector systems that the agents have been giving you can increase your velocity. They reduce your cargo capacity only by a portion, so that's not too bad. But it allows you to go faster. So with the overdrive injector system, this executioner will move 520 without the afterburner, 1072 with. If I offline the overdrive injector system, those numbers change to 471 and 971. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to show you what salvaging really is and why it's a good thing for you. All those locations I saved, let's go to the Blood Raider Rookie Wreck. Wrecks and cargo containers left in space, the ordinary types of cargo containers, will last for 2 hours, and then they will implode, destroying everything that they contained. I'm pretty sure I have not left those wrecks hanging around for 2 hours. This would not be a 2 hour episode. I'm not making a 2 hour episode here. But I can loot this these wrecks. I can target lock everything. And I can run my salvagers. And let me get closer to this other wreck. But when these salvagers succeed, if they succeed, and it got me another unit of metal scraps. So let's turn on the salvagers on this thing. Sometimes you can get valuable stuff out of wrecks, even empty wrecks, if you're using salvager modules. That got me another unit of metal scraps. Let's approach the cargo container. Salvaging gets a lot easier if you can use tractor beams as well. You can use oh, this is mine flood. I don't care about this. You can use tractor beams as well. Tractor beams to pull in the wrecks closer to you. And the salvage modules to then salvage the wrecks. So I have 5 metal scraps. Will I get anything good out of this one? Just another metal scrap. Alright, let me go on to the Corpy Follower wreck. Let's see if I can get anything better out of that. Sometimes you can get valuable stuff out of salvage. Armor plates are a good one. Tripped power circuits. Alloyed titanium bars used to be good. I'll have to double check the market prices on those though. And these salvager modules have an access difficulty bonus. I've only trained salvaging level 1, so it's only at 5%. If I train salvaging all the way up to level 5, then for the tech 1 salvagers, it'll be 25% per cycle. And there was nothing in that wreck. Sometimes you'll salvage a wreck and you don't get anything out of it. It's possible. The bigger the ship that left behind the wreck, the more likely you are to get valuable stuff out of it. And let me fly in between these two wrecks. Full stop, cut the afterburner, and run 2 salvagers on each one of these things. Nothing out of that wreck. Yeah, this process is slow because I've only got salvaging level 1. Ah, here we go. Chipped power circuits. So, these chipped power circuits, the inventory window is estimating the stack at 253,000 disks for all four of them. If you view the market prices, they're going for roughly 50,000 interstellar credits per unit. So, I just essentially got 250,000 interstellar credits richer. So salvaging can be very good good for you if you clean up your wrecks after your missions. Keep in mind that the wrecks will only stick around for a couple of hours. So that demonstration having been made, I'll only salvage this last wreck and then return to station, get my tormentor, and then head out to Penurgmon. I won't waste your time watching me salvage five more missions worth of wrecks. But because you can get good money out of it, it's something that I suggest that you do. And nothing in that one. Alright, so we shall return to station and get started on the last step of the military chain. But yeah, that's how salvaging works. In the case of missions where the different parts of the mission are separated by multiple acceleration gates, you want to bookmark one wreck in each room. Most players will call them rooms, because that's the best way to think about it, and the acceleration gate is the doorway to the next room. While the mission is still alive, hold on. Penurgmon, right click, add waypoint, click accept, and you'll be given a Punisher. We don't need a Punisher specifically, so let's undock. So yeah, with missions with multiple rooms, you want to bookmark one wreck in each room. While the mission is still alive, the only way you can get to those rooms easily is through the acceleration gates. Either that, or slow boat across 10,000 kilometers in the direction the acceleration gate is pointing. Which, even for frigates, is kinda slow. But once the mission has been turned in, that limitation no longer exists, and you can warp directly to the points in space where those rooms were located. So that's why you want to bookmark one wreck in each room. The acceleration gates will no longer be there to guide you to the next room once the mission has gone poof. The mission being turned in will remove anything that was spawned with the mission. But the wrecks and cargo containers were not spawned with the mission. They were created as a result of your actions, which means they don't disappear with the rest of the mission.
Warp drive active.
So yeah, a lot of the early wrecks that you'll come across won't have a whole lot of good stuff, but occasionally you'll get some pretty good salvage, good and valuable salvage. The reason salvaged materials are valuable, the scrap metal just reprocesses into titanium, but things like tripped power circuits, armor plates, alloy titanium bars, and things like that are used to make what are called rigs. Ships and modules are made out of minerals, generally speaking. Rigs, however, are made out of salvaged materials.
warp drive.
And rig slots are the last slots here that I haven't been talking about yet. Once you attach a rig to a ship, the only way to get rid of the rig is to destroy the rig. Sometimes you want to destroy the rig if you decide that you want to change your fitting, or Crowd Control Productions has made a change to a particular rig, and now a different rig would be better for your ship. Or maybe you made a mistake, you need to pull that rig off. Or maybe you want to repackage it so you can sell it directly on the market. You can't sell it rigged on the market. You'd have to use contracts to sell a rigged ship. But that's an entire story unto itself. Rigs require calibration, just like modules require power grid and CPU. And you know what? Load Seamus default. I don't need to see all these things here. Can I activate this gate? No, it's locked. Time to kill things. I forgot to switch to a real stasis webifier. Yes, I did. The civilian stasis webifier only slows a target by 35%, but a Tech 1 stasis webifier will slow down a target by half. Still, 35% is better than nothing, so I will make use of my civilian stasis webifier. Mark a wreck. Save location. All right, good enough. Control space bar. Let's start shooting. By the way, you may notice that I'm still considered only 895 meters away from the acceleration gate, despite apparently being so far from the gate. Geometry in EVE Online can be a little strange at first. If you're more interested in more information on this, search YouTube for a study of geometry in EVE Online. That should pull up a 2014 EVE Online FanFest presentation that I gave on the subject of geometry. I will not take up your time right now with the details here. And... alright, I can't activate the gate. It is locked. Start shooting. Ah, propulsion jamming is complete. So, I would have needed to wait until now before making use of a stasis webifier 1. But when I go back to station, I'll be able to make use of it. Oh, double left click. Around, around, let's go around. The effect of collision surfaces is that it puts additional forces on your ship. Normally you only have your engine force pushing you in a particular direction and drag force slowing you down. and when you're moving at maximum velocity, these two forces cancel each other out. But if you're in contact with another object, then there's an additional collision force pushing against your ship. It doesn't damage your ship in and of itself, but it does interfere with your ability to maneuver. Double left click this way. By the way, if you're not sure which direction something is in and you can click on it in overview, tap C and it will bring it into view. Tap C again to release the camera. Again, that's a default shortcut. You can change that shortcut to whatever you like. Third room of the mission. Now, this stasis tower is going to slow you down and make it much harder for you to maneuver. Thankfully, however, there's an easy way out of this. That stasis tower is scripted to kill itself when the Devout's outpost is destroyed, and the Devout's outpost is a much easier target. So with that being dead, I can now maneuver, I can move around more quickly, if I want to. And this is an example of a graphical glitch. I don't know why that happened. I suspect it's something to do with one of the explosion textures being used here. Very annoying, but nothing I can do about it right now. I'm going to run my armor repairer. And you know what? I want to kill that stolen Navy ship, just because. And this target likes to orbit at long distance, so he's moving directly away from me. And while he's moving directly away from me, his angular velocity is almost zero, which makes him a very easy target. Finally, we have the Devout. This is the mission objective. Just kill him. By the way, I could have instead destroyed the Devout the moment I saw him and then warped away. I felt like killing everything here. That's it. The Devout is dead. I can cut the armor repair. Let me see what loot is in here, if anything important. Control spacebar, open cargo container, food, electronic parts, water, not much. I'll probably loot the other pockets. Hold on, did I bookmark this room? No, I did not. Save location. There we go. All right. I can right-click a wreck and add... Can I add waypoint? I used to be able to. I guess not. Right-click Panergman, add waypoint, because I'll come back here. All right. So, my memory was playing tricks on me. The agent did not give you a tormentor as a mission reward. Rather, the agent gave you an executioner and a punisher. And we can use one of those vessels for the advanced military chain. The tormentor we're flying right now, when I get back to station, I'm going to strip all the fittings off of it, empty out the cargo hold, and I'm going to get out of it, and I'm going to repackage the tormentor. You know what? Let me skip ahead to the part where I return to station. Alright, I've skipped ahead to the part where I have arrived in station. I am going to talk to the agent. And he will give us a sharpshooter skill book, can we inject this? Right click, inject skill. Yes, we can. Excellent. All right, and that finishes the military chain. I am going to... You know what? I am going to just leave the ship, first of all. I can right-click and repackage the Tormentor right away. And that will empty out all of its stuff onto the hangar floor. So all my guns, modules that were fit to a ship, the afterburner, the frequency crystals, all the cargo in it, automatically emptied out. And I will talk to the industry agent. He wanted a Tormentor in the first place. So I click accept. I don't need to carry a Tormentor with me. I've got one in here, so I don't need to worry about the cargo capacity warning. And then complete the mission. And that is it. We are done with the industry and the military chains. Let's see which of these ships we should use. The Punisher has a bonus to small energy turret damage and armor resistances. The Executioner has bonuses to small energy turret capacitor usage and damage. It also has a bonus to reduce the capacitor usage of stasis weapifiers, warp disruptors, and warp scramblers. The stasis weapifiers, as you've seen, can be useful in making targets easier to hit. And what I am therefore going to do... let's see. I shall make use of the Executioner for this. I'm going to go salvage, but when I come back, I will attach the guns to the Executioner, and when I start the next episode, I will have guns on this Executioner. In the meantime, that is it for Episode 5. Episode 6, we will deal with the advanced military chain. Thank you for watching.